Okay, so the third lecture will be devoted to elliptic functions and transformals. I told you that my main interest in this lecture is to work with the exponential function. But even if we are interested only with the values of the exponential function or the logarithm, the classical one, it turns out that it is necessary to extend the domain of the investigation and to study the values of elliptic functions, and also the values of the modular functions. So I will give a brief report on this without going too much into the detail. And I will start with a very brief survey on transformals on algebraic groups. This topic started in the 60s when Cartier and Lang were together in the Bourbaki group. And at Bourbaki meeting, Cartier gave two suggestions to Lang. I know them from each of them, they confirm. And so the first suggestion was to extend Hermite-Lindemann theorem on the usual exponential function to the exponential function of an algebraic group. And this is really how the subject started. It is interesting that there was another suggestion, which was to give a general framework including Siegel's transcendental theorem and Bessel's function. So Lang told me that he remembered there was a second suggestion, but he did not remember exactly what it was. So I asked Cartier, who did not remember at all. So nobody seems to know anything more on that. There may be some general framework which deserves to be investigated, but we don't know which one. So Lang completely solved the first question, and he gave a general result on the exponential function of an algebraic variety or an algebraic group, commutative algebraic group. And it says that if you take the exponential of an algebraic group, if alpha is... Is there a problem with the microphone?
It's my fault. So, I repeat from the start. In fact, it was the microphone for this room and not the other microphone, so it's only for you, not for the record. So, the result of Lang was that if you take the exponential of an algebraic group, if you take a point alpha in the tangent space, in the Lie algebra, such that exponential of alpha is algebraic, the conclusion is not that alpha is zero, but the conclusion is that the exponential of alpha t is a nilpotent matrix. So it happens only in the linear case. It will not happen in the case of an abelian variety, for example. This was the start of the theory, and there have been a lot of results. And what Lang did also is to prove an analog of the Gelfand-Schneider theorem in the same vein. The theory culminated with the work of Wüstholz in 1982, who gave an analog of Becker's theorem. And we can say that now we understand rather well the results of linear independence of logarithm on algebraic groups. What is missing is algebraic independence. And from this point of view, the situation in finite characteristic is much more advanced than in the case of complex numbers. The best results on algebraic independence are due to Damien Roy. And Damien Roy gave an extension of the strong six exponential theorem to algebraic groups. This looks like a transcendence result more than an algebraic independence result, but I will explain the connection between both later. So now I go with elliptic curves, and I explain the analogy between elliptic functions and elliptic curves. I think that each of the three other speakers did it, so I thought I should do it also. The exponential function is the solution of a differential equation. It is also a solution of a functional equation. It is the map from C to C star, which gives a surjective homomorphism from the additive group to the multiplicative group, and the kernel is 2i pi z. So this is the exponential function of some very special algebraic group, which is Gn. if you look at the exponential function of the additive group, it is just the map Z mapped to Z. And now we are going to look at another algebraic group, which is an elliptic curve. I will usually take a Weierstrass model, and this parametrization of the points on P2 is given by the elliptic function of Weierstrass, which satisfies again a differential equation like the exponential function, but it's a little bit more complicated, and an addition theorem. So this R is a rational fraction in two variables. So the exponential map of the algebraic group E of C is given by 1 P of Z, P prime of Z. I take a projective point, so I have a projective coordinates. And the kernel is a lattice in C, so it's a Z module, which is discrete, of rank 2. We are going to be interested especially in the periods, which are the elements in C, such that P of Z plus omega is equal to P of Z. So this is exactly the kernel of the exponential map. And you saw in the previous lecture how to compute the periods as integrals. And so what we do, the writing is slightly different from yesterday, but it's amount to the same. We compute the integral of dt over square root of 4c3 minus g2t minus g3 between ei and infinity, and e1, e2, e3 are just the roots of the polynomial which is here. So this gives a pair of fundamental periods. One important function will be the modular invariant, which you can define when you start from a Weierstrass elliptic curve. But also you can consider it as a map which is analytic in the upper half plane when tau is omega 2 over omega 1. And it has a Fourier expansion at infinity by putting, because it's periodic of period 1. And so if you put q equal exponential 2i of pi t, you have the development of j of q, which starts, as is well known, by 1 over q plus 744 plus and so on. So it's a series in q with just 1 over q in front. So this modular function will play an important role. You heard a little bit about complex multiplication. It will not be so important to know the connection between complex multiplication and the result, but since it occurs in several lectures, I give just a few words about that. When we have an elliptic curve attached to a Weierstrass P function, the endomorphism of E is a ring which is either Z or an order in an imaginary quadratic field. And it is different from Z if and only if the quotient of two fundamental periods is a quadratic number, which is the case of complex multiplication. This is equivalent to say that the two functions P of Z and P of tau Z are algebraically independent. And in this case, the value of the modular invariant is an algebraic integer of degree the class number of the quadratic field. We will use, for example, the fact that if the quadratic field has class number 1, then J is just a rational integer. The field Q of square root of minus D is the field of endomorphism. It is an imaginary quadratic field with class number H, and there are H non-isomorphic elliptic curves, E1, EH, where the ring of endomorphism is the ring of integers of k. This number g of ei associated with these curves are conjugate algebraic integers of degree h, and each of them generates the Hilbert class field of k. And the Galois group of h over k, of the Hilbert class field over the imaginary quadratic field, is isomorphic to the ideal class group of the ring of integers of k. So the complex multiplication of elliptic curves gives the solution of the Hilbert class field in some way which is analogous to what happens with the cyclotomical extension which occurs from the multiplicative group. So we are interested in transcendence questions. And the first one is the transcendence of the periods of an elliptic function. The first elliptic analog of the Lindemann-Weierstrass on the transcendence of pi came in 1932 in the work of Ziegel, who proved that if the invariant G2 and G3 are algebraic, one of the two numbers, omega 1, omega 2, is transcendental. It was a very partial result, but it was the first result in this direction on elliptic functions. And also, it was the first result where Ziegel used the construction of auxiliary function by means of Dirichlet-Box principle to give a transcendence proof. So this turns out to be very important for the solution of Hilbert's seventh problem 2 years later. In the case of complex multiplication, to say that one of the two numbers is transcendental is the same as to say that any non-zero period is transcendental, because any non-zero period is a multiple by an algebraic number of omega 1. And the algebraic number is just an imaginary quadratic number. No, it's a number in an imaginary quadratic field, I should say. So let me give some numerical example. The first example which I take is an example where there is complex multiplication by by Q of I. The field of endomorphism is Q of I. So the quotient of the two period is just I. And if you compute one period, which one does not matter too much because all the others are multiple with an element of Q of I. If you compute this integral, you find a value of the beta function, which is given as gamma of 1/4 squared divided by square root of pi. So from Ziegel's result in 1932, it follows that this is a transcendental number. So this is the first example with multiplication by Q of I. If you take an example with multiplication by Q of the cube root of unity, which corresponds to J equals 0, then you get the curve y squared equals 4x cubed minus 4. And a fundamental period is given again by an integral, which is the value of the beta function again, which is given by gamma of 1/3 now. So again, this number is a transcendental number. We saw that the gamma function occurs as well as the beta function. So the gamma function, I defined it yesterday. It is essentially the canonical product of Weierstrass corresponding to the poles which are minus the integers. This is the canonical product of Weierstrass. So the poles of gamma are zero and the negative integers, and there is just a normalization factor with this gamma is Euler constant. And the beta function is the quotient of gamma values, and it is an integral, and this is the representation of beta as an integral, which explains the role of the beta values in this theory. The formulae which I just showed you are special cases of a general formula which gives the values of the gamma of 1/4 and gamma of 1/3 as series involving the points in the lattice. The formula of Chao-Eisenberg in 1966 gives general result, a general connection between expression of periods of elliptic curves with complex multiplication as products of gamma values. So I told you that the consequence of Ziegel's result are that these numbers are transcendental. And other consequences of Ziegel's result are transcendence of some definite integrals like this one. And in fact, you know that the name elliptic curve does not mean that we have an ellipse. It comes from the fact that this elliptic curve were constructed in the 19th century, starting from the question of measuring the length of an arc of an ellipse. And this length is given by some integrals. And if you invert the integral, you find the elliptic functions. So this is the connection between the ellipse and the elliptic curves arises from these integrals. Also, if you look at the transcendence of the perimeter of the Lilly skate, which is given by this equation, again, you get transcendental numbers by Ziegel's result. And this, in fact, is an elliptic curve, in spite of the fact that you have degree 4. And in fact, it's a curve of genus 1. Other connection with the periods and the numbers are values of Gauss hypergeometric functions. So you saw this function in the lecture of Paula Cohen. This is F21. Maybe it was Fritz Böckers, rather. Yes, Fritz. And so, in fact, some example of F21 value is 1/2, 1/2, 1, and at z squared. And this, again, gives the integral. And so, some results on the transcendence of values of hypergeometric series arise from the elliptic integrals. So, I told you several times that in 1934, Gelfand and Schneider solved Hilbert Seven's problem. So this was for the classical exponential function. And the same year, Schneider went further and proved that each non-zero period of an elliptic curve where G2 and G3 are algebraic is transcendental. And it gives the fact that the non-zero period of an elliptic integral of the first kind is transcendental. It is equivalent. After the first kind, we can look at the second kind. And the elliptic integral of the second kind corresponds to quasi-period of an elliptic curve. So if we want to investigate them by using functions, elliptic functions, we introduce the zeta function. And for that, we first introduce Weierstrass sigma function. The sigma function is the canonical product of Weierstrass, which is associated with the lattice. And so we put z, which is 0, before, and then we have a product of 1 minus 1 over z, and then we have an exponential here. This exponential will not introduce further zeros, but it is done in such a way that the product converges, and what is written here is just the start of the development of the logarithm of 1 minus 1 minus z over omega, in such a way that this product is very close to 1. And then this product defines an entire function, which has a simple zero at any point of the lattice. So this was introduced by Weierstrass. And if you look at the canonical products, you have several examples of canonical products that we saw. The one which is associated with the non-negative integers is essentially 1 over gamma of 1 minus z, as I pointed out before. If you look at the canonical product for the rational integers, positive or negative, this is just sine pi z divided by pi. Here, I have put together z, n and minus n in such a way that we do not need the exponential of minus z over n. So like this, it converges. And so this is a well-known development. But if you look at the special value, which is z equal 1, then you will get development of pi over 2, which is a product of, so here you have the 4n squared, so it's a z equal 1/2, rather, 1/2. So you have a 4n squared denominator, and then the 4n squared minus 1 there. So this gives a development of pi over 2, which in fact goes back to Wallis in 1655. Now, the canonical product which I introduced just before is the canonical product associated with z plus zi. And the special value of this, which is specially interesting, is 1/2. It's interesting because if you compare the multiplicative group and the elliptic curve, in the multiplicative group, the canonical product is associated with z, with the sine of pi z. And if you take the half of the period, you get an algebraic number. So it would seem rather natural to expect that if instead of an element in omega, you take half an element, you would get an algebraic number. But in fact, the number which we get is exactly this one. It can be computed. And it turns out that this number is a transcendental number. This was proved just 12 years ago by Nesterenko. And I will come back to this result. But you see that it involves only pi, exponential of pi, and gamma of 1/4. I introduced the zeta function as a preliminary step to get the Weierstrass sigma function, which is a logarithmic derivative of sigma. And the derivative of zeta is minus p. The minus is just in such a way that p of z starts with 1 plus 1 over z squared. So because the function p is periodic, zeta is quasi-periodic, which means that if you add a period to z, you get zeta of z plus a constant. And this constant is called the quasi-period of the Weierstrass zeta function. In fact, the quasi-period is omega. Zeta satisfies zeta of z plus omega minus zeta of z is a constant. But eta is called the quasi-period. So these numbers are the quasi-periods of the elliptic curve. And you have seen yesterday the Legendre relation, which gives omega 2 eta 1 minus omega 1 eta 2 equal to pi I. The sign plus means that you have to choose the ordering of omega 1, omega 2. And here we assume that the imaginary part of omega 2 over omega 1 is positive. So this gives the normalization. We can go back to the example that we had before. If we start with the first example with gamma of 1/4, we can compute the quasi-periods, eta 1 and eta 2. And it was pointed out yesterday that there is a further relation between eta 1 and eta 2. And the further relation is eta 2 equal minus I eta 1. And for the curve with gamma of 1/3, again, you have a relation between eta 1 and eta 2. And the value of eta 1 and in each case is given by some gamma values with 1/4 or 1/3. And it will be the same in the case of complex multiplication. The transcendence of periods and quasi-periods was investigated by Polya, Popken, Mahler, so there are several results on that. But Schneider proved the sharp result in 1934 in the same paper as before, which is that the numbers eta of omega are all transcendental when omega is non-zero. And for instance, we have further transcendental numbers involving gamma of 1/4 and pi, or gamma of 1/3 and pi. So there are some further results which have been obtained by Schneider on the transcendence of quotient of numbers. And he succeeded to go further and to get some result in higher dimension. The result which is here is just for elliptic curves, but this one involves abelian integrals of higher genus, which are related with the Jacobian of Fermat curve. So if you look at the periods of the Jacobian of a Fermat curve, the Jacobian of a Fermat curve is an abelian variety. And then it has periods, and the periods can be expressed in terms of the gamma values. And using this representation, Schneider extended the proof of transcendence that he had in 1934 to prove some transcendence results on the periods of abelian varieties. And as a consequence, he got the fact that beta of A and B is a transcendental number. To go further, we had to wait until 69, when Baker used the method which enabled him to prove the linear independence of logarithm of algebraic numbers, and succeeded to get the linear independence also with algebraic coefficients of some periods and quasi-periods, including the fact that if you take a linear combination of these numbers, then it is a transcendental number. The first result, he did not prove the linear independence, but it was proved a little bit later, as you will see. The transcendence of linear combination with algebraic coefficients of these numbers n to pi I was achieved by Coates in 1971. And also, Coates proved that in the non-CM case, the three numbers omega 1, omega 2, and 2 pi I are linearly independent of a Q-bar. Finally, Masser solved completely the problem. And what he proved is what was expected, that if you take the six numbers which are here, they span the Q-bar vector space of dimension 6 in the CM case, and 4 in the non-CM case. In fact, Masson did not know that there would be two relations in the non-CM case. There is one relation which is clear, omega 2 over omega 1 is algebraic. And so Masson tried to prove that the dimension is 5 in the non-CM case, and he failed. And then by looking more precisely at the situation, he found another relation, and he did not know at the beginning that this was known for a long time. But this was known for a very long time. And so now Masson found exactly the right result for the linear dimension of the space. And also he gave some measures of linear independence by the same method, which is an extension of Baker's method to elliptic curves. So what I said so far deal with periods of elliptic integrals of the first and second kind. And there are a few results with elliptic integrals of the third kind, and also with abelian integrals of any kind, which I shall mention later. The results of Schneider in 1934 were more general than that. He gave some results saying that, this is just the elliptic analog of the Hermite-Lindemann theorem. If beta is not a pole of P and is algebraic, so P of beta in this case is a transcendental number, assuming G2 and G3 are algebraic. But this result was a special case of a much more general result, which involves the zeta function. This result here corresponds to B equals 0, but you can take A and B, two algebraic numbers, which are not both 0. Then for any U in C minus omega, so it's not a pole of P, one of the two numbers is a transcendental number. And I will explain tomorrow some ideas behind the proof of that, which is the so-called Schneider-Lang criterion, which came a little bit after in the work of Schneider. Schneider proved in his paper three theorems. The first one I just mentioned. The second one is in the same vein. You have two functions, P and P star, and you assume that they are algebraically independent. You assume that all the invariants are algebraic. Then for all T, which is not a pole, one of the two numbers P of T and P star of T is a transcendental number. So the two functions cannot take simultaneously algebraic values at a non-zero point. And another example is that if you take the two functions P and the exponential of T, they cannot take simultaneously algebraic values at a point which is not a pole of P, always assuming G2 and G3 are algebraic. So these are the three results you see. This involves P and exponential of T. This involves two elliptic functions. And the previous one involves P and AZ plus B zeta of Z. And each time the result is the same. It's not possible that the two functions take simultaneously algebraic values. If you take B equals 0, it means that you look at the two functions Z and P of Z. So all these results here are in the same direction. A corollary of Schneider's general theorem is an important one on the transcendence of the modular function. If you take a point in the upper half plane, and if you assume that J of tau is algebraic, you ask whether it's possible that tau is algebraic. So this is the set of exceptional points for the J function, but only in the upper half plane. It can happen that tau is algebraic and J of tau is algebraic only if tau is imaginary quadratic number. And of course, if tau is an imaginary quadratic number, I told you before that this is true, both numbers are algebraic. Tau because it is quadratic and J of tau because of the complex multiplication. An open problem, which is very intriguing, is asked in Schneider's book on transcendental numbers in 1957, which is to give a proof of this result, not using elliptic functions, but using the J function. And there have been some progress towards this question, because it's possible now to prove some results using modular functions. But this problem is not yet solved. So we do not know how to prove the result which is here using modular function. Without using elliptic functions, we do not know. And the talks of Paula Cohen are based on this result. This is the basic result which gave rise to the theory that she describes. And all what she is explaining involves abelian functions, so abelian varieties. And one main tool is Wüstel's theorem. But the result which she is going to introduce is a result concerning some functions for which we would like to have proofs involving only this function without using abelian varieties. And we have no idea of that. We have some ideas for Schneider's second problem, but they are not yet sufficient. So the sketch of proof of the corollary is the following. You assume that tau and j of tau are both algebraic. So since j is algebraic, there is an elliptic curve with algebraic invariance and periods omega 1, omega 2, such that j of tau is given by the j of the elliptic curve, and tau is omega 2 over omega 1. Now we consider another elliptic curve. We have the elliptic curve P, which is associated with G2, G3. And we look at the elliptic curve P star, which is tau square P of tau z. The tau square is just in such a way that this is a P function. So it's a Weierstrass function with algebraic invariants G2 star and G3 star, which are algebraic. And now, if you replace u by omega 1 over 2, you see that the two numbers, P of u and P star of u, are algebraic. And so from the theorem of Schneider, it follows that the two functions are algebraically dependent. And it is known that if the two functions are algebraically dependent, it means that the corresponding elliptic curve has non-trivial endomorphism and tau is quadratic. So this is the sketch of the proof. And once you have this, it's not difficult to complete the proof. Okay, so I give you some examples where we can say that two functions cannot have simultaneously algebraic values at a non-zero point, say. We have another example with the solution of Hilbert Seven's problem by Gelfand and Schneider on the transcendence of alpha to the beta. The fact that alpha to the beta is a transcendental number means that if you take the two functions, exponential of z and exponential of beta z, they cannot take algebraic values at the point log alpha. So it's the same kind of statement that we have here, but it's a bit more specific. A special case of the Gelfand-Schneider theorem is the transcendence of exponential of pi square root of 163. So this was the basis of a short note in the American Science magazine. It was dated from the 1st of April, and I don't remember exactly which year, and it was signed by Martin Gardner. It was maybe 30 years ago, and Martin Gardner said, nobody knows whether this number is an integer or not, and some people are computing it with many decimals to see whether it's an integer or not. And Martin Gardner knew, of course, that this is not an integer, it is a transcendental number. But what is interesting is that some scientific magazine in France reproduced some months later the same information without noticing that the date of publication was the 1st of April. So the fact that this number is very close to an integer occurs from the fact that if you take tau equal 1 plus I square root of 163 over 2, and if you compute q equal exponential 2 I pi tau, it is a number which is very small, because this is a rather large exponent, and it is exponential minus this number. Now, I told you that the number j of tau is an algebraic integer, and the degree of this algebraic integer is the class number of the field q of tau. And this is the largest discriminant of an imaginary quadratic field with class number 1. So the class number is 1, and therefore j of tau is an integer. And you can compute it, this is the integer. And because of that, j of tau is very close to 1 minus q minus 744. So 1 minus q is very close to an integer. And the 744 is the one which you find here. So this is the explanation of the fact that you have a number which is very close. Ramanujan studied a number of similar properties for all the values of the radical. I told you that Baker extended the result of Gelfand and Schneider to linear independence of several logarithms. Gelfand-Schneider theorem is the fact that if log alpha 1 and log alpha 2 are linearly independent of a cube, then they are linearly independent of a q-bar. And Baker, in 1966, got the general result that if log alpha 1, log alpha n are linearly independent of a cube, then 1 log alpha 1, log alpha n are linearly independent of a q-bar. We already saw that yesterday. The elliptic analog was a challenge for some time. And the first main result was obtained by Masser in 1974, who solved the question in the CM case. In the non-CM case, the question was solved in 1980 by Bertrand and Masser. And it was a very interesting proof that they gave. They used a result which is the Schneider-Lang criterion, which I will mention tomorrow, for several variables, but in a case which is rather well-known and easier, which is the case of Cartesian product. This is exactly the situation that Schneider used in his paper in 1949 when he proved his result on the transcendence of beta of A and B. Schneider worked with a period of Abelian integrals, so he needed several variables, but he needed it only in the simple situation, which is the situation of Cartesian product. It's much easier, but it's not trivial. It requires some work. And what is interesting is that Bertrand and Masser found that Baker's theorem is a consequence of this result of Schneider, which goes back to 1949. So, in fact, the question which was asked by Gelfand on the linear independence of logarithm of algebraic numbers could have been solved without using the transcendence machinery of Baker. It may be very good that Bertrand and Masser found that after Baker, because the solution that they give does not give some good low bound for linear forms in logarithms. And the interest of Baker's method is mainly in the quantitative estimate. So it may be better that this was found only later. But also, the proof by Bertrand and Masser works in the case of elliptic functions. So the result which they obtain is that if P is a Weierstrass elliptic function with algebraic invariance, if U1, UN are logarithm of algebraic points, so this means that there are complex numbers and the value of the PI are algebraic numbers. Or the omega I, the UI are in omega, they correspond to periods which are considered as logarithm. Then the numbers 1, U1, UN are linearly independent of the q-bar. So this is really the analog of Baker's result for elliptic curves in place of the multiplicative group. As I told you in the first transparency, Wüstolz extended this result to Abelian variety and integrals, also to elliptic and Abelian integrals of the third kind. He got a general linear independence result for commutative algebraic group, which extended Baker's theorem. And all this was developed further by Wolfhardt and Wüstolz on the transcendence of the values of the beta and gamma function, and also on the linear independence of the values of this function, of these values on the algebraic number field. And among the consequences are the transcendence of the values at algebraic points of hypergeometric functions with rational parameters. So we mentioned mainly elliptic integrals of the first and second kind. Elliptic integrals of the first kind are related with elliptic curves and the periods of elliptic curves. The one of the second kind, the eta 1, eta 2, are related in fact with an extension of an elliptic curve by the additive group. As far as the third kind is concerned, they are related with extensions of elliptic curves by the multiplicative group. But if we just speak of functions, we can look at the quasi-periodic relation for the Weierstrass sigma function. Zeta is obtained as a logarithmic derivative of sigma, and so the quasi-periodicity of zeta gives a relation between sigma of z plus omega and sigma of z. But it is a multiplicative dependence relation, and we have an exponential here, eta I z plus omega I over z. It was pointed out by Serre in 1979 that this relation gives some functional equation for the function fu, which is sigma of z plus u over sigma of z sigma of u, exponential of minus z zeta of u. This function satisfies the functional equation. And in fact, the interest of this function is that this is a function which occurs in the parametrization of the extension of an elliptic curve by the multiplicative group. When you look at this as an algebraic group, it has an exponential function, and the exponential function is given by fu. So this is the explanation. In such a way that, in the same way as zeta, the zeta function is associated with the parametrization of the extension of an elliptic curve by Ga. And so, using this, it's possible to prove some results on the transformance of some values of this function, which in fact are related with periods of elliptic integrals of the third kind. So it's possible to deduce the transformance of periods of elliptic integrals of the third kind. I mentioned here a research topic which you may be interested in, which is the following. If you look at what is published so far, there are many results which deal with elliptic integrals of the first and second kind. And there are some very interesting numerical examples, like the one which involved the beta function, so gamma of 1/4, gamma of 1/3. And there is not so much which has been done on the third kind. From the theoretical point of view, we know Wüstel theorem, which in principle gives all the linear dependence relation. But to derive explicit consequences may be something interesting. So this is just a suggestion. So we discussed the question of linear independence. Now I would like to go to another question, which is related with the algebraic independence, but also related with the sixth exponential theorem. I mentioned it yesterday. We can state it by saying that the rank of a matrix, 2×3 matrix, whose entries are logarithm of algebraic numbers, is maximal, equal to 2, under some natural assumption that the rows and columns are linear independent of a cube. And I mentioned yesterday the four exponentials conjecture. We expect that the same is true just for a 2×2 matrix. Such a determinant should be different from zero. The four exponential conjecture is a consequence of the main conjecture for usual logarithm of algebraic numbers. And I will discuss that in more detail on the last lecture. The main conjecture is, if you take logarithm of algebraic numbers which are linearly independent of a cube, they should be algebraically independent. The result of Baker is that they are linearly independent of a cube bar. But so this means that we look at the linear relations of degree one. But they should be algebraically independent. No algebraic relation between them. So if you look at the determinant is a polynomial in the log alpha, and so it should not be zero unless in trivial circumstances. So this is really the main conjecture, and there is an analog of the main conjecture, which is that if you take complex numbers which are linearly independent of the field of endomorphism of E, and you assume that there are logarithms, which means that the P of UI are algebraic, then they should be algebraically independent. So the condition here is that they are linearly independent of the field of endomorphism. This is the start of a set of conjectures on which I will not say more, which has been developed by Grothendieck, André, and Bertholin, involving more generally abelian varieties. So to come back to the sixth exponential theorem, There is some analog which has been investigated by Lang and Ramachandra, and they obtain some analogs. And I just give one of them, but there are other ones. The one which I give is not the most general, but it's really the analog for an elliptic curve with complex multiplication. In this case, it looks exactly the same. You take a 2x3 matrix. You assume that the entries are logarithm of algebraic numbers for one p function. And you assume that the columns are linearly independent over the endomorphism, the rows also, and then the conclusion that the rank of the matrix is 2. So we have a perfect analog in the case of elliptic curves. These are the first steps towards algebraic independence. I should say that this result on the six exponential theorem has been extended by Damien Roy to, as I explained before, instead of taking logarithm of algebraic numbers, he takes linear combination of logarithm of algebraic numbers, and he has a similar result. And this is a main step, I think, towards results of algebraic independence. But for algebraic independence, there has some very strong theorem which has been achieved by Shunovsky in 1978. He obtained the fact that two of the numbers G2, G3, omega 1, omega 2, eta 1, eta 2 are algebraically independent for an elliptic curve with invariant G2, G3 and fundamental periods omega 1, omega 2. This is probably the first result, transcendence result, where it is not required that G2 and G3 are algebraic. If G2 and G3 are algebraic, among the four numbers, you have two algebraically independent. But this is a little bit more general. He has another theorem, which is, there is no link between them, so there is no one which is stronger than the other. If you assume that G2 and G3 are algebraic, if you take a non-zero period and eta, the quasi-period of the zeta function, and if you take a point u, which is not in C and which is not a rational multiple of omega, which is in C and which is not a period but not a rational multiple of omega, and which is a logarithm of P of an algebraic point, then the two numbers which are there are algebraically independent. It's remarkable because very few things were known at that time on algebraic independence. And this is one of the very first, very strong results. In particular, he deduces that if you take a non-zero period of omega and a quasi-period eta, when G2 and G3 are algebraic, the two numbers pi of omega and eta of omega are algebraically independent. And in the case of complex multiplication, we deduce that omega 1 and pi are algebraically independent. The pi arises from Legendre relation between the numbers. The numerical example which I gave before show that pi and gamma of 1/4 are algebraically independent. Pi and gamma of 1/3 are also algebraically independent. There are further consequences of that. There is a conjecture of Lang which says that if j of tau is an algebraic number and the j prime of tau is not zero, then j prime of tau should be transcendental. It is the same as the transcendence of omega square over pi, because the differential equation satisfied by the modular function. And from Shunovsky's result, we deduce that this is true in the CM case. If j prime of tau is not zero, then pi and j prime of tau are algebraically independent. J prime of tau different from zero means that G2 and j are non-zero. So in these cases. The method of Shunovsky gives something for gamma of 1/3, gamma of 1/4, and gamma of 1/2, because it's square root of pi. It gives also something, the method gives something for gamma of 1/5. And what it gives is that two of the three numbers pi, gamma of 1/5 and gamma of 2/5, are algebraically independent. I said yesterday that we do not know whether gamma of 1/5 is irrational or not. If it is rational, then pi and gamma of 2/5 are algebraically independent. But we expect that the transcendence degree should be 3. The proof of Vassiliev and Grinspan uses the Jacobian of the Fermat curve, which is an abelian variety of dimension 2. And probably it's possible to go further on this topic by investigating further the situation which is there. Another result on the algebraic independence of the values of P function was achieved by Philippe van Bustels in 1982. They obtained the elliptic analog of the Lindemann-Weierstrass theorem on the algebraic independence of the exponential of alpha 1 and alpha n in the special case where there is complex multiplication. So when there is complex multiplication, if alpha 1, alpha m are algebraic numbers which are linearly independent over the field of endomorphism, the numbers p of alpha 1, p of alpha n are algebraically independent. But this is in the case of complex multiplication. And otherwise, the problem is open. The proof is not quite complete that n over 2 of these numbers are algebraically independent. They have partial results toward this, and this is maybe something which could be proved now, but the proof is not yet written. The next progress on this domain came from the question of... Okay, so I will just say that... So Mahler and Manin posed a problem which was solved by the people in Saint-Étienne, which is the following: if Q is algebraic, then J of Q is transcendental. For Schneider, it was tau and J of tau, and now it's Q and J of Q. And it was the first proof using modular functions in the direction of Schneider's problem. So, I give. Okay, so I was too optimistic. There are a lot of consequences which... I just finished by saying that Nesterenko in 1996 went further and proved that the three numbers pi e to the pi and gamma of 1/4 are algebraically independent, and also pi e to the pi and gamma pi square root of 3 and gamma of 1 of the 3. But we do not know with the gamma of 1/5. So this is an open problem to extend the result to gamma of 1/5. Okay, so I will put the transparency on my website. So I was quite wrong with the preparation here. So thank you.